worship to our God. What a great way to start the service. You guys can have a seat. My name is Kelly Horan. I'm the Weekend Reach Director, and I just want to say thank you so much for coming here and worshiping with us, whether you're here in person or whether you're online. Maddie is going to be helping with me with announcements today. And so we're going to go through a couple that we have. The first one is I just want to recognize any veterans that are here. If there are any veterans, could we have you guys stand up? Could we just have any veterans of some way, shape, or form? Yes, let's give them a round of applause. Thank you so much. Thank you for your service. Thank you that we can have the freedom to worship here because of you guys and what you have done for us. We are just so blessed to have you here. We also want to welcome any of you that are guests. For the first time, we do have a Connect card, and you can see up here on the screen. We would love for you to fill that out back at the welcome table, and you get a free gift from us just to say, hey, thank you for coming here, worshiping with us, and we want to get to know you a little bit. We're not going to, you know, blow your email up with spam or anything like that. We don't do that. We just want to reach out and say thank you. And then also, I know that we have this kind of new QR code. So I want everybody to take your phones out. It's okay. We can have our phones out. Everybody take your phones out. And Maddie.
Yes.
It's been a while since I've done a QR code properly. So can you teach me real quick?
Okay, I'll show you. So what you do is you take out your camera, just like this. All you're going to do is point it at that scanning thingy.
And I got to sometimes zoom in, right?
You got to zoom in a little bit, and then it should bring you straight to
you can see over here or over there. If you're online, you can scan the QR code also that's at the bottom of the screen. And then it brings you to our website where you can just fill out your name, your email. If you're a first-time guest, a returning guest, or a member of Grace, we just want to know that you guys were here. So again, we can reach out and just say thank you. You can also add anything that you're more interested in learning about. And then also, please, if you're not signed up for our e-newsletter, that you get that. We have so many announcements on there. So that's a good way to connect with the church and, you know, kind of.
Kelly, can I just interrupt you? I'm so sorry.
Oh, yeah.
I love your necklace.
My necklace?
Yeah.
Thanks. I got this at the women's jewelry sale here at Grace a couple years ago.
I got my necklace from there, too.
I was wondering. Yeah. Your necklace is so pretty.
Thank you.
It looks really expensive.
No, it's not. $2 to $20.
Yeah, that's how much this was. This was
$2.
$2. And like in a store, it would be like $30.
Yeah, it's really
so,
nice.
It was so
a little
cool.
Distracting.
So that's in the El Rio room.
Yeah, it's going to be in the El Rio room from 9 to 1.
Okay, 9 to 1. And I know like it would be really cool to get gifts for.
Yeah, if you have any last minute gifts that you need to get, it's an amazing way to get something really special for someone you care about.
Yeah, good last minute. I'm just starting.
And actually,
shopping.
Kelly, it's something that's done by women for women.
Okay.
All the proceeds go to women in need, which is really awesome.
Oh, that's so cool.
Yeah.
I love it. So, jewelry sale, I know they have necklaces, they have earrings. What else do they have?
They have bracelets, they have rings as well.
Oh, yeah.
And we actually do need some volunteers for that as well. So, if you're interested, please come see Kelly afterwards to sign up.
I'll get you connected. So, a really cool event, you guys, for women, by women for women. So, a great way to support the jewelry sale here at Grace that we're so happy that we can actually have it again. It's just awesome. There's so many good items. I walked through and I was like, ooh, I want that, I want that, I want that, I want that. Like, it's really, really cool. I love it. So, we're also going to have the cherubs singing with us later today, so I want to welcome the preschool families. I see a lot of you guys down here. We're just so happy when they sing. They are just so cute. You just want to, like, squeeze them. And we also have more new members joining today. So this is just amazing to see what God is doing at this church. I've been here for a while, and just to see how many people are just continually becoming, you know, new members and calling Grace their official home. If you're interested in becoming a new member, please find me or Jason after the service, or you can email us and contact us anyway, you know, like that. We have so many ways to get connected here at Grace.
Absolutely. I'm actually a new member myself. Recently, I joined the church, so I wanted to hear something more about, like, little things I could join. We actually have a Sunday morning adult group from 9:15 to 10:15. They're going over Ephesians right now, and you can join at any time. If you haven't been there before, it's okay. You can just come on in, and you can get started from wherever they are that day.
And they also have free childcare, so if you have children, you can just drop off your kids and then go, study Ephesians.
Yeah, and we also have a 9:15 to 10:15 youth group as well upstairs. It's for middle and high school students as well. If your kids are interested in something like that, it's great.
And they have free breakfast.
Food.
It's always good to mention free food for kids. We also have Blast on Wednesday nights, and that's for the elementary age children. And the first Wednesday of every month, we have a parents' group that meets. And we were supposed to meet last Wednesday, but it needed to be rescheduled. So if you weren't able to come last week, try to come out this week. It's on. It's at Wednesday. It's at 5:30 in the El Rio room. If you're not sure where that is, just come here and we'll direct you there. And it's an amazing time of fellowship with other parents. You get to kind of learn to be a better parent, which I look forward to. It was a great time last time I was there, so I was really bummed that we had to move it, but I'm excited to be there this Wednesday, so it'll be awesome. We are a really active church, you guys, and there are so many other announcements that we could be giving, but we want to direct you to our website at graceboca.org. Sign up for that e-newsletter. It's amazing. It has everything in there. It also has prayer requests, people you can pray for, or you can actually send in a prayer request. I think that's it.
That's it?
Yeah, that's it. So at this time, I'm going to call the ushers forward. We're going to pray over our offering. Let's go ahead and bow our heads. Father God, thank you for today. Thank you, God, that we get to be here and to worship you. God, that we can honor you with our hearts and with our minds, that we can just lean into you, God, and to just put everything else that is in our minds away, God. The hustle and bustle and the chaotic life that we lead, Lord, that we can just have this time of peace and not look at the clock and not wonder what else is happening outside of here, God, but that we can focus on you, that you are in the forefront of our minds, God, and that we can just focus on that. We pray, God, for this offering, that we can serve you even more, God, in some way, shape, or form, that we can reach our community, God, that we can show others all about you. We thank you, God, that you bless us, that you continue to bless this church. God, we thank you so much. Continue to be with us through the rest of the service as we worship. Open our hearts, God. Open our minds. We love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Overcome by your presence, Lord.
Father God, those words are so powerful. Thank you, God. We thank you that you can meet us here, God, no matter what we're going through, no matter what we're feeling, God. We thank you that you are here next to us, carrying us at times. Thank you, God. Thank you that you meet us here no matter what. Bless us, God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Amen. And as Kelly prayed and as they sang, I'm not enough, we're not enough. Unless you come, God, will you meet us here? Will you meet us here again? God has created us with a place in our heart that can never be filled with anyone or anything other than him. And when he fills that place, we know, and it overflows in gratitude. So that's our prayer, is that God is meeting you and filling that place in your heart of hearts, and that it's overflowing in gratitude and in praise and worship. It's while we're here, and it's the blessing of worship together. So we're so glad that every single one of you are here on this beautiful, wintry, fall, Florida Sunday morning. Yeah, exactly. You know, it's funny. I look out and I see some flannel shirts on and some jackets. We kind of busted into our winter gear when it dips under 60. I remember when we first moved here, we'd get those robocalls from the county office when it would get under 60. And they'd say, you know, make sure you have your kids dressed for winter weather today. But it's so good. This is perfection, South Florida perfection right here. So we're so glad that you're spending this beautiful, perfect Sunday morning with us, at least weather-wise, and we hope it's a very wonderful Sunday for you, aside from the weather, too. And it's a good day for us at Grace that you've come to join with us, and it's just our honor to welcome you. All the preschool families, excited about the preschoolers be here on these risers later on this service. So thankful when they lead us in the worship of God. As Kelly said, we have some new members joining us. Always exciting to welcome new friends into the family at Grace. And maybe we have some first-time folks here with us. And it's our prayer that this is a good experience, a positive experience for you, and that you feel the presence of God. As we've been singing and praying and spending time together, that you feel, first of all, the presence of God with you and for you. Maybe you're here for the first time and you came to the Fall Festival a couple of weeks ago. And if that's the case, we hope that you're coming here, you feel the same welcome that you felt outside, that you feel the same thing on Sundays, and that God will lead you back as often as possible. So speaking of the Fall Festival, just a question for you. I wonder how many of you remember seeing a really tall worker who was working one of the games. If you were at the Fall Festival, it's a really, really tall guy. Some of you remember him? I have a picture of this guy. There he is. You see? I mean, he's towering above this mass of people. That you didn't really get the crowd effect there, but I remember looking out and seeing this massive crowd of people, just heads, mostly 6 feet or under. And then there's this guy who must have been close to 7 feet tall, and he's just like standing up head and shoulders above everyone else. And what was cool was to see him, you know, helping the kids out. You see his smiling face. He's a nice, fun-loving guy, but he's helping the kids, and the kids are like 3 feet tall. He's like close to seven. And so seeing him reaching down to hand the kids the balls or whatever, was a cool thing to see. I just saw some families taking pictures with him. It's like he was a celebrity. But it made me think of a picture that I had seen probably 4 or 5 years ago where the Guinness Book of World Records arranged for the tallest living man to meet the shortest living man. And we have that picture here. Isn't that something? So get this. This man is 8 feet 9 inches. 8'9". The guy at the Fall Festival is probably 6'9", maybe a little taller. So this is 2 feet taller than that. Incredible. And the guy down below is 1 foot 9 inch. 1 foot. So 7 feet difference. And here they are shaking hands. I love this picture. So you can take that down now. But it makes me think about some Bible trivia. So we'll have a little Bible trivia time for you now. So I wonder if you can shout out who you think, or first person that comes to your mind, as the tallest person in the Bible? Goliath. Very good. Awesome. Well done. All right, the next one is who first comes to your mind when you think about the shortest person in the Bible? Very good, Zacchaeus. Well done, friends. I'll have to keep on with the Bible trivia. That's fun. So the preschoolers, as I said, they're singing this morning. My wife, Christy, is the one who leads the kids in the singing. And so the week or so prior, I'm hearing these songs through the house, and she's singing them and just prepping for having the kids on Sunday. And it made me think about when I was learning songs like that as a preschooler, and I remember learning one about Zacchaeus. Anybody remember learning a song about Zacchaeus as a kid? Some of you do. I'm going to spare you the singing. If my wife was in here, I'd have her sing it. But the lines go like this. Zacchaeus was a wee little man, and a wee little man was he. He climbed up in the sycamore tree for the Lord he wanted to see. And when the Lord came walking by, he looked up in that tree and he said, anybody know what he said? There you go. You learned the song. Zacchaeus, you come down, for I'm going to your house today. That's a song that's ingrained in my memory from preschool days, maybe yours too, as you can see. And it's a song that comes straight from the Bible. Those lines are such a great recap of the story of Zacchaeus and Jesus in the Bible. And we're going to read that story today from the Gospel according to Luke in the New Testament of the Bible, chapter 19, and reading verses 1 through 10. Let's listen for God's word. Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through, and there was a man named Zacchaeus, and he was a chief tax collector, and he was rich, and he was seeking to see who Jesus was. But on account of the crowd, he could not see because he was small of stature. And so he ran on ahead and he climbed up into a sycamore tree to see Jesus, for he was about to pass that way. And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and he said to him, Zacchaeus, hurry and come down, for I must stay at your house today. And so Zacchaeus hurried and he came down and he received Jesus joyfully. And when they saw it, they all grumbled. He's gone in to be the guest of a man who's a sinner. And Zacchaeus stood and he said to the Lord, behold, Lord, the half of my goods I give to the poor. And if I have defrauded anyone of anything, I restore it fourfold. And Jesus said to him, today salvation has come to this house, since he also is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. Zacchaeus really, really wanted to see Jesus. This man that everybody was talking about, this man around whom this crowd had formed, he really wanted to see Jesus. Only trouble was he couldn't see above the crowd because he was short or small in stature, as the Bible says. And so he ran on up ahead down the road. He found a tree alongside the road. Sycamore trees were often planted beside the roads in that day. And he climbed up in that sycamore tree. Now, you think about it. A grown man climbing trees isn't just kind of the ordinary, normal, everyday thing that you come across. It certainly isn't in this day. Likely wasn't in that day either. But when you really, really want to see someone, or when you really, really want to see something, a lot of times people will do just about anything. I have to tell you, last week and the week before that, I really, really, really wanted to see the Atlanta Braves play in the World Series. In person. Exactly. Yeah, go ahead and give the Braves a hand. Yeah, so I actually, just out of curiosity, just went online to see what the tickets might range. And that would have been Christmas for the next 15 years for the Whitener family had I done that. But what was interesting was that they actually had standing room only tickets. I can't remember if that was in Atlanta or Houston. I was looking at both places. But standing room only tickets. So you think about it, you're paying $1,000 or more for a ticket that gets you into the stadium, but when you get in, you don't have a seat. You're just standing with a sea of other standing room only ticket holders trying to get a view. But unless you're the guy at the Fall Festival, the 8'9" guy, you're there with the rest of the six footers or under, you're gonna have a hard time. If I had gone there with my family, my daughter, who's in middle school, would have had to get on my shoulders in order to see anything. But some people wanted to see the World Series that badly that they'd buy those standing room only tickets just to get inside and be a part of the atmosphere. Let me tell you, it was very tempting. Zacchaeus really, really wanted to see Jesus. And he didn't care what that meant. He didn't care what people thought about him. And so he climbed up in that tree to see Jesus. And when he saw Jesus, he didn't just see Jesus with his physical eyes walking down the road. He also saw Jesus with his spiritual eyes, you might say, with the eyes of his heart. And when he saw Jesus, Jesus also saw him all the way down to the heart of his heart. And when Jesus saw Zacchaeus, Jesus loved Zacchaeus, this man whom no one else really did, this man whom most others despised because he was a tax collector, as we read in the Bible. And so the Jewish folks, resented this, that he was taking up money on behalf of the Romans. These people were occupying their land, and most of these tax collectors were known to be very corrupt. And the Bible doesn't say that Zacchaeus is just a tax collector. Do you know what modifier is used? Did you pick up on that? He's the chief tax collector. Tax collectors are mentioned a lot in the Bible. It's the only place in the Bible where a chief tax collector is mentioned. Probably meant he oversaw other tax collectors in that area, which means he was a notch or two higher in the ranks, so to speak, which also would mean that he would be likely a notch or two lower in the perception of the people. Jesus, though, reached out to Zacchaeus. He noticed, he recognized him, he reached out to him, he visited his home, and ultimately Jesus rescued him and changed him in grace and in love. And just listen to some of the words that the Bible uses to describe this experience. It says Zacchaeus hurried down the tree. He was rushing down the tree. He didn't just come down. He hurried down the tree. He joyfully received Jesus. He was happy to welcome Jesus. And he stood there, the Bible says, likely with his mouth to the floor that Jesus had even paid him any attention. He stood there and he said to Jesus, "Look, half my possessions, Lord, I'll give to the poor. If I've defrauded anyone of anything, I'll pay back four times as much." This guy was going to give half of what he had, and he was going to pay back four times as much anything that he had cheated. And it's going over and above and above and beyond. And the key here is that he was doing this willingly and joyfully, not reluctantly. He wasn't doing this because he had to do it, because he was being forced to do it. He did it willingly and joyfully of his own free will, as a way of giving with a spirit of thanking, as a way of thanking with a spirit of giving, as a way of giving thanks to and for Jesus. Giving, thanking, giving thanks. That's the key. Zacchaeus, see, he had a change of heart and a change of life because of this encounter with Jesus. He changed not because he was trying to earn Jesus' love. He changed because Jesus' love had come to him and found him first. And he could not contain, he could not hold back the overflow of gratitude. It's been said that Zacchaeus might have been small of stature, but he became a giant of gratitude and a giant of generosity. Giving, thanking, giving thanks, because he had seen Jesus with the eyes of his heart. Jesus had seen him down to the heart of his heart. And Jesus had opened Zacchaeus' eyes to see more clearly who God intended for him to be. Today, in these next few weeks, we're going to be thinking about giving with a spirit of thanking, thanking with a spirit of giving, and giving thanks to and for Jesus. Because however we're giving, if we're giving money to the church, we're giving money to some other organizations, if we're giving gifts to people, loved ones or friends, if we are giving time and energy to something, if we're giving our heart or soul or mind or strength, if we're giving ourselves, if we're giving of ourselves, our giving ought to always be in a spirit of thanking, you see. Not giving in order to get, which is a lot of times what people do, give in order to get something in return. But not giving in order to get. Giving in order to give. And giving in order to thank. And thanking in order to thank. Giving thanks always to the one and only one who was, is, always will be the giver of every good and perfect gift, as the Bible says. Zacchaeus, you can see it in those words of description. He was eager. He was eager and he was ready, first of all, to see Jesus. And then after having that encounter with Jesus, that life-changing, life-transforming encounter with Jesus, he was eager and he was ready to give, to thank, and to give thanks. And I asked myself, am I as eager? Jason, are you as eager? Are you as eager and as ready as Zacchaeus was? First of all, to see Zacchaeus, or to see him more clearly with the eyes of my heart, to see him in new and fresh ways as the Holy Spirit reveals him more and more to me day by day. And then, Jason, are you as eager and as ready to give, to thank, and to give thanks to and for Jesus, for who he is and for what he's done? Are you ready to see Jesus? Are you eager to see Jesus, maybe for the first time in a meaningful kind of way? Or are you ready to see Jesus in a new way, a fresh way, with the eyes of your heart? Are you ready for Jesus to see you, to see you for who you truly are deep down in the heart of your heart? Are you ready for him to see you? Are you ready for Jesus to open the eyes of your heart that you might see more clearly who God intends for you to be and how God intends for you to live? Maybe as we're talking today about how God intends for you to give, to thank, and to give thanks to and for the giver of every good and perfect gift. Because you know this, Jesus isn't going to walk down Camino like he walked down the road in Jericho. And so we don't have the chance to go climb up in a sycamore tree to get a better, clearer view of Jesus with our physical eyes. But I want you to think about something else. I want you to think about climbing something else in order to have, in a sense, a better, clearer view of Jesus. Think about climbing on the shoulders of those who have gone before. By climbing up on the shoulders of those who've gone before, that by having that better view, you might have a clearer sense of who Jesus is. Back to a little bit of the World Series. So if you watched any of that, you might have noticed that there was a lot of tribute paid to Hank Aaron, and rightly so. Hank Aaron died earlier this year, and so the tribute was in the World Series. It was all through the season for the Atlanta Braves. Because Hank Aaron, if you don't know, was kind of the epitome of Atlanta Braves baseball history and culture. And when the Braves won the World Series, which was a beautiful, wonderful moment, by the way. I'm a Braves fan, if you don't know that, from Atlanta, all the rest. So, but when they won, the owner or the president of the Braves, whomever it was, I can't remember, but they were presenting the trophy. And that person, as they received the trophy, they were speaking of Hank Aaron, right? And they also spoke of Phil Niekro, and kind of you had the sense that this was a part of something bigger than that particular team. You had a sense that they were that they were standing on the shoulders of those Braves greats who had gone before. My son Brian, he actually saw something yesterday. He showed it to me. So the professional baseball season is split into two parts. So there's the pre All-Star break, and there's a post-All-Star break. And so he saw someone had found and discovered that the Braves, prior to the All-Star break, won 44 games. After the All-Star break, they won 44 games. They won the World Series in the 44th week of the year. You know what number Hank Aaron wore on his jersey? 44. That just gives me goosebumps right there, right? That's something. This whole thing of standing on the shoulders of those who've gone before, it plays itself out with baseball, but it's also that concept very much applies to faith as well. We stand on the spiritual shoulders of those who've gone before us. By the grace of God, one day there will be, maybe there already are, those who stand on our shoulders, on your shoulders, and through that, by the grace of God again, they might have a clearer and better view of Jesus. Upon whose shoulders do you stand? And who is standing on yours? And when they stand on your shoulders, what do they see? And who do they see? Do they see Jesus? Do they or will they see Jesus by standing on your shoulders? I want to ask you to do something for me today. I'm going to put my cell phone number up on here, and I would love it if you feel comfortable just texting me some names that come to your mind of the ones upon whose shoulders you stand, all right? You can just put a first name there if you want to. If you want to put a first and last name, that'd be great. If you just want to be a little more vague and put my mother, my father, my aunt, uncle, my grandparent, anything like that, I would love for you to text me these names. I'm not going to call any of you out. I'm not going to embarrass anybody. I'm going to include those names, though, in a prayer a little bit later. So I'd love for you to text me just right now and through the rest of the service, my number's going to be up here, a name or names that come to your mind of those upon whose shoulders you have stood. And on the flip side, you can also text me a name or names, either particular names or vague, of those whom you pray, whom you hope will stand on your shoulders. And through that, they might come to better, more clearly see Jesus. So go ahead and text me those names. I'd love to be receiving those. Now, if you are someone who really doesn't have names to send, if you don't have a name that comes to your mind of someone upon whose shoulders you have stood, or a name of someone that you would hope and pray might stand on your shoulders, or if you are at a place maybe where you haven't had that experience of seeing Jesus in a deep and meaningful way, but maybe you're interested in it, or you're curious about that, and you might just want to learn a little bit more. If that's the case, you can text that number the same thing. Again, I'm not going to call anybody out. I'm not going to embarrass anybody. I'm not going to call any of your names, but if you text me that, I promise you, I'll be in touch with you. I'll reach out, and maybe we'll connect and see where God goes with it. No judgment whatsoever. But if you do have a name or some names that you've texted me, I want you to think about something, especially names of those who have gone before you in life and also in death. So those names that maybe you sent me who are no longer with us in this earthly journey. Just imagine that you put those names on a piece of paper, all right? And you hold on to that piece of paper every single day for the rest of your life. That piece of paper, that list of names means so much to you. And then someone has said something like this, to imagine it unfolding this way, that on the last day of your earthly life, and you die to this life, and you, by the grace of God in Jesus, are welcome to the gates of heaven, and God meets you there. And God says to you, you went into this life with nothing, and you come out of this life with nothing. So what is that you have there with you? And you say, Jesus, you say, God, it's just a list. It's a list of some names of some people, you know, that helped me out along the way, some people, you know, upon whose shoulders I stood, and without them, I may not have seen or known Jesus, or I may not have seen and known Jesus as clearly and as meaningfully as I did. And you give that list to God, and God takes that list, he looks at it, and he says, I know these names. I know every single one of them. And you know what? I just came past them on my way here, and they were painting a great big sign. And that sign actually was being painted for you. And on that sign were written the words, welcome home. Welcome home. You know what, friends? I don't know if that's how it's going to unfold in heaven, but I like to think it might be something like that. We had a very longtime faithful member and friend of our church who was just welcomed to heaven hours ago, this morning. He just died. And I like to think that all those upon whose shoulders he had stood previously were welcoming him home. Harry Kersey was his name. Longtime faithful friend and member, loved Jesus and loved people. And today he's been welcomed home. You just think about that with that list of names that comes to your mind and God seeing that list and all those welcoming you home on that day, which will surely come for all of us. Now, on that day, you think about it, nothing on this earthly life will mean a thing. Our things won't mean a thing. All that will matter is that we have seen Jesus with the eyes of our hearts, that Jesus has seen us down to the heart of our hearts, and that the faith, hope, love, and trust of our hearts are in him and in him alone. It all comes down to that, friends. Is the faith and love and hope and trust of your heart in Jesus and in him alone? If it is, praise God. Praise God and keep on giving with a spirit of thanking and thanking with a spirit of giving and giving thanks to the giver of every good and perfect gift. If not though, if not, my hope and prayer is that it will be, that you will see Jesus, that Jesus will see you, and that Jesus will change you as he changed Zacchaeus for his glory and for your good. That's my prayer. That's our prayer for every person here today. Let's go to God in prayer. Father, thank you so much for every single person here, Lord. Thank you for the names that have been given. We're so grateful, God. We're thankful for Ron and Janet Tacy, for Sarah and Steve Markham, for Uncle Wayne and Aunt Margie, Anthony Costa and Grandma Margaret and Grandma McCoskey. Thank you for Jesus. We're thankful, God, for a grandfather, Daniel Claiborne, and Father John Sidney, and for the son, Daniel John. Thank you, God. Thank you for the family, for Ivan Barros and Miriam Barros, Zoraid and Francisco, and prayerful, God, for Noah and Chloe, and will be on our shoulders. And God, we are grateful for a maternal grandfather, a former pastor in South Carolina, Jim Glatz, for a friend, Pele. We're also prayerful, God, for a son, for three grandkids and other friends in Christ. Father, we thank you for Maritza Chapman. We're prayerful, God, for four children, husband, grandchildren, all the souls who come to this person's office or come across their path with the stand on their shoulders. Lord, we're thankful for Elizabeth and for Pat and for Jason. God, we're thankful for Michelle and Shelby and Diana and Pauline, and prayerful for Benjamin, Andrew, and Michael. And Father, we are prayerful for Thelma and for Cameron, and we're just prayerful for both of them. We're prayerful and thankful, God, for Victoria, for Sheila, and for Barbara. And God, for Desmond, and for Robert Desmond, for Martha, and for John. And for Matthew, a brother-in-law who passed away. God, for Lisette, to stand thankful for this person standing on their shoulders, and prayerful that Maya stands on this person's. For Adam and Ben and Alex, for Mom, Alina, and Jane, Tom Best, Cindy and Bill Hall, for the parents, and prayerful for the children. Prayerful, God, for Jason and others who help you see Jesus. Prayerful, God, for Mom, for Matthew, for parents. Prayerful, God, and thankful for Mary, for Chanel, for Mom, for Diana and Carter Strickland, for a mother, Laura Lee, for Ed and Brian, and prayerful for Adam and Anthony, for Donald Skensey, for Alex Miller and Alexander Miller, for Luke, for Erica. And God, we're prayerful for all these people, God, and so many others. Lord, the names keep coming. You are hearing every one of these names. We're so thankful, so grateful, God, for those who've made an impact, especially those who've helped us see Jesus. Help us, God, by your grace to see him and then to be shoulders upon which others stand, especially these precious children. We're going to be coming in these doors in just a moment. God, we give it all to you for your glory in the name of Jesus. Amen. This was beautiful, friends. They just kept popping in. And I'm going to pray through every one of those names, okay? So just trust that. Thank you for blessing me with the people who have blessed you. So I'm going to invite the Cherub Choir to come on in, and we will welcome them forward. And if the light folks could turn up maybe the front row of lights, maybe even the front two lights, so we could see the cherubs better. It'd be fantastic. Amazing. Thank you so much, friends, including the big preschooler over there. We appreciate that. Y'all are the best. I want to invite the new members, if you haven't already done so, to make your way to Kelly, and so we can get you up on the stage. Thank you so much, guys. You're amazing. I love your shirt. I love the Snoopy sweatshirt. Woodstock. Yes, sir. The winter clothes coming out. I would love it if they sang every single Sunday. That'd be fine with me. If it'd be okay with the parents, it'd be fine with me. They're amazing. All right, we're so privileged to welcome out onto the stage our newest group of new members to the Grace family. So thank you guys. We may still have a couple more coming out here. Awesome. Good deal. Hey, Connie. Everybody. Fantastic. So I'm going to just call their names out alphabetically because that's how they're going to be online. So just when I'm calling your name out, if you wouldn't mind just doing a little wave, that'd be great so people can see who it is I'm speaking of. So we have Chris and Jennifer and the rest of the family. I saw Jennifer here. Here she comes. There we go. They have, this is impressive. They have, how old? 9 weeks. And I think y'all were coming at like 2 weeks, right? Or 3 weeks to come into worship. Amazing. This is Chris and Jennifer. And Lily just sang. Awesome job, Lily. And then we have Cole and little Blake, little 9-week-old Blake here. So precious family. We have Connie Palladino. Some of you may remember Connie. She has been connected with our church for some time. We're so glad to welcome you back and to welcome you home, Connie. We have Terry and Shelby Pfister and Lanaya, who are here with us. So privileged to have you. And also on the end, Tony and Diane Ritano. So welcome. So glad to have these friends. I'm going to ask you, Kelly and I are going to ask you the questions of membership. And so I'm going to stand over here by her so you're not like getting whiplashed by looking back and forth, okay? So the first question I'm going to ask all of you as a group, do you confess that you are a sinner in the sight of God, and that your only hope is through God's sovereign mercy? Do you?
Do you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ as the Son of God and Savior of sinners? And do you accept and trust in Jesus alone for your salvation from sin and death? Do you?
And relying on the Holy Spirit, do you promise to live as a follower of Jesus? Do you?
Do you promise to serve Jesus in the church by supporting and participating in its service to God and its ministry to others to the best of your ability? Do you?
And do you submit yourself to the government and discipline of the church and promise to further its purity and its peace? Do you? Amen. Praise God. We're gonna say a prayer. And after the prayer, I'm going to escort the families around the back, and they'll stand over here by the door. And I hope that you will have a chance on your way out just to greet them, to congratulate them on this occasion, and to welcome them. If you're already here at Grace, to welcome them into the church family. If any of the rest of you are interested in a step of membership and making those commitments that you just heard them make, again, I'd love for you to reach out to Kelly or to me. We'd be so privileged, blessed, and honored to speak with you about that. So let's go to God in prayer for these families. God, it's such a privilege to be a part of your church because, Lord, it's a family. And we just thank you for the family of faith here at Grace. Certainly not a perfect family, God. We have our flaws and failures just like every other family in the world, just like every other church family. But God, we're blessed and thankful to be together because you've called us together. And so I thank you for these families and individuals, Lord, and am grateful for what they bring to you here at Grace and for what we will all continue to bring for this church and through the church to the community and the world together for your glory, God. Bless them. Bless us all together in the name of Jesus. Amen.